Welcome, Karan. I'm not going to waste time introducing you. Anyone watching this knows you. So we'll just get right to it. A politician who should really know what he's talking about and was in a position to know since he was in charge of that ministry said to me once that you have handlers in Pakistan. And when one reads your articles related to Pakistan...
What's a handler?
Handler is somebody who's telling you what to do, what to write. Obviously, you know what a handler is. Don't play innocent on me. When Mumbai siege was going on, there were handlers.
I thought handlers were what spies had to tell them what to do. So are you suggesting I'm a Pakistani spy?
This is what this person, a politician, said to me, that you, not that you're a spy.
And you believed it.
But that you push their agenda. And when you reach...
You believe it.
It's possible, because when you read, for example, July 25th, 2010, your article on Pakistan and India relations, the whole article is presenting Islamabad's point of view, not Indian, and not even considering it.
Okay. If you believe it and think it's a credible comment, well, you obviously think it's a credible comment worth asking,
yes,
rather than dismissing. So the truth of the matter is, no, I'm not a Pakistani spy.
A spy. I ask you whether you're pushing Pakistan's agenda, because most of your articles are written from a Pakistani point of view, their point of view, the Islamabad's point of view.
I have never met anyone who has made that comment to me before you did. I've never had anyone ask me if I have handlers in Pakistan, as you suspect I do, because obviously you think it's worth asking. I don't think I've ever written anything that gives that impression.
You know, if you lead an insular life and people don't come up to you and say what a lot of people talk about, and if you read the blogs and if you read comments on your articles, you would see that
People think I'm a Pakistani spy.
I never said that. I said that you push Pakistan's agenda. There's a big difference between spy. I don't think you could be a spy. But I do think that there have been incidents, particularly your driving Ashraf to Advani, which has been, okay, you have your contacts, fine, from your parents' time, fine. The point is that your articles particularly show a marked Pakistani point of view.
Well, I'm surprised you say that, but I'm sure there may be others who feel the same thing too. I don't think they show a marked Pakistani point of view. From time to time, certainly my articles present a Pakistani point of view, because I think as Indians we ought to be aware of it.
Now, your interview with Kapil Sibal on Devil's Advocate, you must have seen the comments on all that.
People, no, I haven't seen the comments.
There were a lot of comments on how you let him get away with everything, and whatever statement he made, you didn't really play the devil's advocate in that interview.
Viewers have a right to that view.
Yeah, but there were points where you actually helped him. You know, I mean, when he says there's no pre-screening, when you quoted to him that the Hindu had already published that a senior official of the department had said that there will be, we've asked them to screen, actively screen and filter all sites before it's uploaded. Now, if it was anybody else, you would have really gone after that man. You don't let go usually. You let this go. You just moved on to the next thing. And then you're helping...
No, hang on, I didn't just move on to the next thing. I made him repeat twice that there would be no pre-screening and that it wasn't his intention. I pointed out...
But his government had already announced there would be. Now, normally you would go after, but your government's announced it. It's announced it. You would have gone after him. Tooth and nail, you would have gone after. But you let it go. You just repeated it and established that, okay, now you've said it.
Forgive me. This government hadn't announced anything at that point of time. This interview was done 2 weeks ago to the day. At that point of time, the only information we had officially about this was from the New York Times, from the Heather Timmons article that was put up on the New York Times website, and the brief press conference that Kapil Sibal had had. In the brief press conference that Kapil Sibal had had, he'd actually gone out of his way to say that they didn't want pre-screening. I then quoted to him what the New York Times had said, and he turned around and said that the New York Times had been misinformed. He suspected, although that may not have been exact words, that they had been... stories leaked to them by the
This is not like Karan. Karan normally goes after a guy. You can't. So what you're saying is that they were failing to live up to their standards. And Kapil Sibal says, absolutely, they were failing to, you give him the words to say. Then he repeats what you say. Again, in other words, this is a sort of double standards that they're setting. There is no doubt about
but
that.
Forget
you're sort of giving him a dialogue to help him out.
I'm not giving him a dialogue to help him out. If you look at the answer that he gave before, in other words, you're saying, I'm actually summing up and putting to him what he's saying so that the audience can understand.
You're making it easier for him.
I'm not making it easier. I'm clarifying.
And then when he, you say the newspapers also say that an official of the American embassy contacted an additional, he said, I don't want to talk about these things. Now, normally when somebody says, I don't want to talk, you go after them. Why don't you want to talk about it? You have to, you're answerable, you're accountable. You just let him go.
I didn't let him go.
Yes, you did.
No, I didn't let him go. If someone doesn't want to talk about it, why do I want to waste time on that when there are other things I want to talk about? After all, there are so many other things that I need to clarify about the story. If you're not going to clarify
this... When a person says that they don't want to talk about something, you normally just let it go?
It depends. No, hang on a second. It depends, A, upon the importance of the subject. Number two, and I think of that whole issue, I don't think this was the most important. It also depends upon how much else you have to cover. And it depends upon the fact that you don't have time.
Now, this Chidambaram, you had to put a disclaimer that he wanted to see it before it went out. Why did you agree to that?
I had been asking Mr. Chidambaram for an interview for about 2 years. He had been repeatedly saying no. Eventually, one day, he said to me on the phone, send a researcher so that I can lay down the ground rules. I said, I've come myself. After all, the ground rules have to be reserved by me. No one else. He said, no, I insist you send a researcher. So I said, fine. A researcher went, and the simple ground rule was, tell Karan, I'm happy to do the interview, but I want the last word whether it's shown or not. So I consulted Rajdeep, and we came to the conclusion that if we didn't agree, there would be no interview. But if we did agree...
But did he talk about changes?
Not one.
Did he say that if I would have the last word on changes, would he edit it or would he just say it would run or not run?
Oh, actually, to be honest with you, we didn't explore it that far. He spoke to my researcher. He said he wanted the last word. Eventually, after discussing it internally,
we agreed. So any other politicians who've asked you this?
Can I finish this story? Because I think it's important. Don't say oof. I thought you're interested in what I'm saying.
No, bolo.
So we agreed. We went and did the interview. When the interview was over, he had Shubhashish Gangopadhyay, his advisor, sitting there with him. He asked Shubhashish if it was okay. Shubhashish was highly embarrassed, said, of course, nothing wrong with it. So he said, fine. We then came back and put a caption on top to say that the interview was granted on this condition. We agreed because if we didn't, there would be no interview. And at the end of the interview, we put up another caption which said, absolutely no change was requested by Mr. Chidambaram and none has been made and the interview has been broadcast as recorded.
Do you ever plan to be rude? Because many times there are situations where you are rude.
Well, if I am rude, then that is clearly a lapse on my part.
Because you can't help yourself. It just happens. When you get really exasperated with someone.
No, I think people can always help themselves. I don't think rudeness just happens. It ought not to. Anchors and interviewers should be sufficiently in control of themselves. And if I am rude, then that is clearly a lapse.
You had a terrible reputation at one point for interrupting all the time. It was like Kiran Bedi looks for publicity. Karan Thapar interrupts all the time. And I noticed that you interrupt less, but the reputation continues. People still say Karan Thapar, rude, keeps interrupting. Well, did you sort of think about that and say, I've got to, or did your mother tell you stop interrupting?
Reputations linger for much longer than the reality that they supposedly represent. So I'm not surprised that that reputation lingers. One, I suppose I interrupt less because I've grown older. Two, you learn from experience. And certainly when people keep telling you interrupt too often, you say to yourself that obviously they can't be wrong.
You've had Ram Jaitmalani walk out of an interview.
Yes.
Now, when Ram Jaitmalani walked out, so he says, he starts screaming at you and he says, you come with a loaded mind, loaded question.
Calm down a moment.
No. Sorry.
Calm down a moment. And
you are your old self. You decide, you assured me that you have improved, but you have not. I'm sorry.
Now, look at your face here. You look like you're going to cry.
What, you may think so, I certainly
didn't. No, you started begging. Calm down, don't go. You're begging him. First, you're the bully. You're asking him all these horrendously aggressive questions. And then when he gets up to leave, then you're like, no, calm down, please be. And you've got this baby, cry baby face that, oh my God, I've lost the interview. At one point he asked me, you told me that you'd improved. And that's how I agreed to the interview, all right, in the one that he walked out. What did you tell him that you'd improved from? What was your conversation when you were asking him for the interview? And he said as he got up, he said, you told me that you've improved. Mm-hmm. What did you tell him?
He asked me before he agreed to that particular interview whether over the years I thought I had matured and become a better interviewer and I had improved. And I said, yes, I had.
Come on. You must have made some promises to him.
I did. I made no promise to Mr. Ram Jaitmalani other than to give him an objective platform.
Because you had a lot of time after that, about 5 or 6 minutes. And you used up that time by just giving your own viewpoint.
Actually, I explained to the viewer what it is that I would have asked Ram Jethmalani,
yeah,
and why I thought without those were critical questions.
Without him having
And I didn't use up 5 or 6 minutes. I actually think took up about 2.5 minutes. And that interview, by the way, is no more than 17 minutes long.
No, you
long,
took up four. You
long.
Took up over 4 minutes.
Okay, but the interview is not the full 20 minutes of Devil's Advocate. It is actually 3 minutes less or 4 minutes
yeah,
less.
Yeah, but that the rest of the time, where which is supposed to be a program with an interview with someone else, you use that time to just talk about your viewpoint, basically.
Well, it wasn't
what
my
you
viewpoint.
Would have
no,
asked it, him, it, and you
no,
don't have the answers,
no, no.
And you're just presenting your point of view.
No, I'm not
it's
presenting
your
my
agenda.
Point. No, it's not. I'm afraid you're wrong. If it was my viewpoint, it would be my agenda. It was the questions I would have asked.
No, but that's
confidence.
Hardly the issue. The issue
well,
is
I mean,
that
it
he
is
walked
the
out.
Issue because that's
he walked
the point
out, and then you take over 4 minutes. Just hogging the camera, talking to yourself.
Well, you
it's,
may
it's unheard of.
Well, maybe.
It's not even journalism.
Well, I'm not.
It's just a speech.
Well, if you thought so, you're obviously entitled to. But the thing is that, as I pointed out, it won the Asian Television Award with an international jury and 65 countries participating and 1,500 entries.
Okay, that's
for
enough
best,
of your pook.
Well, it's not pook. I think it points out that your opinion may not necessarily be either a majority opinion or even the correct opinion. I think I'm allowed to make that point politely.
No, the point is that if you, it's the same thing as Ram Jethmalani or Narendra Modi saying that everybody supports me. You're using the same logic which you put him down for.
You're entirely entitled to that view.
You know, he said the same thing to you, and he said, you said you're just talking about people. Where are these people? You're talking about the same thing. The bunch of people who might be agreeing with you doesn't mean that they're right, which is the point you made with Narendra Modi just before he walked out.
I get the feeling that this is, forgive my saying so, revenge for the book review I wrote, which you hated.
Would you think I'm so petty?
No, but you're not letting me finish
not
my answer.
Not in the least, not in the least.
You're not letting me finish
any
of my answers.
I'm doing my interview as is. And if I was going to take revenge in such a petty way, it wouldn't be done like this.
Okay. It's just that you won't
I would deal with that issue.
You're not letting me
finish. If I was to take revenge, I would bring up that issue.
You're not letting me.
Where I don't think you'd come across looking good at all. So I'm not even going to bring it up.
You're not letting me finish any
answer. That, because I'm doing a Karan Thapar interview.
Okay. But then if you
Karan Thapar will always interrupt, and so will I. All right? That's the deal. And I'm surprised that you would stoop so low as to think that I would take revenge on that stupid book review. Come off it. I have more class than that. You were low enough to do something. Don't bring me to your level. I would never do that. I ignore it. If I was going to deal with that and take revenge, that would have been my first question and handled it.
It was just a suspicion that came to my mind.
Grow up. Grow up. Watch this.
A bit difficult if I haven't grown up already. Madhu, I'm 56.
I'm giving you some hope.
At this
okay,
late
watch
stage,
this.
Growing up becomes
Shut up
very
and watch
difficult.
This.
I think I'm condemned to be a perennial child or a juvenile or an idiot.
Watch.
I'll have to rest. Purple water. Yeah.
You came here. I'm happy. I'm thankful to you.
Now look at your face. Again, you look ready to cry. Come on, Karan.
Okay.
You really look like you're going to cry.
Well, Madhu, if you think so, I can't dispute it because...
Ask your mom, ask your sister, ask anyone. You look like you're going to cry. So basically, you're a bully. You bully, bully, bully. And then until, like all bullies, when they stand up for themselves, then you're a baby.
Okay.
Then it's boohoo time for you.
Well, if that's your view, I obviously not going to disagree. But, you know, I must simply add that you're the very first person who's ever said that I looked as if I was going to cry either in the Jethmalani or the Narendra Modi interview. But if that's what you perceived me to be doing or feeling, how can I dispute it? Your perception is your perception. I can't say you're wrong.
Okay, now your interview in 2007 with Ram Jethmalani about his taking up Manu Sharma's case. In that, was there any answer you wanted from him?
No.
Because you spent, let's see, you told him that he'd betrayed his principles, scattered morality and ethics.
Has he scattered all morality and ethics to the winds? Ram Jethmalani picks cases to attract attention to himself and to create controversy. It's publicity he's seeking. He's using Manu Sharma to build a career that is flagging. But the manner in which you're defending Manu Sharma, is it moral?
I mean, you've fallen from your own high standards, deliberately spreading lies,
so
you have no conscience.
What's the point?
You
what do all these examples
were
illustrate?
Were you looking for any answer from the guy,
no.
Or were you just going to harangue him?
Well, if you think I was haranguing him,
No, I can't. What do you mean if I think?
Incidentally, the most important thing about the interview you're about to play there, which is the Manu Sharma one, is that it was recorded twice. What you saw and what went on air, and oddly enough, that also won an Asian Television Award for Best Presenter. Was the second version.
You're so impressed with yourself, Karan. Stop it.
Well, okay, I imagine that you've got me here for some reason that is wildly or thinly connected.
You're a journalist and a good one, but you know, there
are
issues.
Thank you for the compliment.
There are issues. They're controversial issues. That's why you're here.
I'm happily answering them. When we did that interview, it was done in December, in the evening, after the first version, because there was a lot of quarrelling going on between us. I said, don't you think we should do it again? Because all we've done is shout and over-talk. He said, happily, Karan, happily.
So this was the second version?
This is the second version.
And this is not quarrelling?
This is absolutely. That's what I'm saying. It's exactly the same. And the other interesting thing is that when the second one ended, he said to me, "Arey yaar, hun chhad, let's have a drink." And I wrote about that, in fact. He invited me to stay and have a whiskey. I had a quick whiskey with him. He said, hold on. I said, okay, I can't. I'm meant to be meeting my sister at the gym, which is across the road from where you live. And I wrote about that in Sunday Sentiments. And I pointed out to people that the impression that they may have formed of Jethmalani from that interview is totally belied by the truth, which is that this is one of the nicest people I know. Number two, he did it twice. Number three, he offered me a drink. And number four, he was extremely pally and friendly.
There are certain people that people are just nice to, just to be on the safe side. And you're one of them. So don't think that people love you just because of your lovely personality, which is fine. But
you're jumping to the wrong conclusion.
What could be ruder than that? Is this?
I don't deny that there were many things that were injudicious and cheeky.
Are you a man of character?
Well,
is this the behavior of a man of character?
I will leave now, please don't get into this kind of bullshit.
When there's almost
the way I'm holding an interview.
When there's almost a smile on your face, I'm not sure if it is a smile or not. It's time for me to apologize for the impertinence.
Thank you. So apologize for the impertinence.
Yes, but
I'm glad you played that particular bit, because that shows that in fact Karan himself, even in the interview before it ended, was aware that he had crossed a certain line, both in tone and content, and apologized for it. And
but
as
Karan,
I said to you,
you go after people. No, you can't. You go after people
but don't you think
in such a ruthless, relentless way, regardless of any decency,
Madhu, my darling,
common courtesy.
You're good
it is
at
very
imitating,
clear,
Karan.
That you're
you
writing
do it brilliantly.
And doing what you do
but
on television, regardless
Karan,
of how you use people, abuse people, needle people, anything to get your article read and program talked about. Is there a Karan there, as Karan says? Is there a Karan there who cares at all about all the people he has hurt or damaged? You seem to care little for relationships outside of your own family, and I presume you must have some friends. I know you have one who's a real shark, a barracuda, who I know. Is it all about Karan Thapar and his career? Is it about survival and using any means to get ahead? Have you used the British style of being mean to build yourself up, regardless of who how many people you trample on? A psychiatrist would look at you.
There must be 20 questions
yes,
there.
Of
Which
course,
one
I'll
do you want me to answer?
I'll give you a chance. A psychiatrist would possibly look at you and say you're a frustrated, very, very, very frustrated man on any level, on every level. The need to keep beating up on people just to create a show. Well,
I love you,
there's
Madhu.
A smile
you're
on
wonderful.
Your face.
You're
it
wonderful.
Is time for me to apologize for the impertinence. And thank you for the interview.
You're wonderful. I love it. You're wonderful. You're wonderful. God bless you.